Good evening, everyone. I'd like to warmly welcome you all. Thank you so much for joining us tonight. This is our first event of 2017, but of the 2016-17 academic year for our Veritas series for Faith and Culture. And again, very, very pleased to have you all here. My name is Melissa Page Nichols, and I have the privilege of serving as pastoral counselor here in the Office of Campus Ministry at King's, as well as part-time faculty in the School of Social Work. As you may have seen when you entered the theater, there is a donation box just inside the doors. 100% of the donations collected will be going to our King's Refugee Sponsorship Initiative. The beautiful artwork that you also hopefully saw displayed outside the theater on your way in is by our own London award-winning painter, Jamie Jardine. We're most grateful for Jamie's contribution of his work for our promotional materials, as you'll see on the brochures for the series. He's best known for his landscapes of Canada, and we felt that his work was most fitting for this year's theme, God Keep Our Land, inspired by Canada's national anthem. Tonight's presentation is being sponsored by the London District Catholic School Board, and we are pleased to have three of the principals of the London District Catholic School Board joining us in the audience tonight. I now have the pleasure of introducing our speakers for this evening. Marie Antoinette Paricio, who prefers to go by Toinette, is member of L'Arche London and regional leader for L'Arche Ontario. L'Arche is an international community, a movement of people with and without intellectual disabilities. L'Arche was founded in 1964 by Canadian humanitarian and social visionary Jean Vanier. Distressed by the institutionalization and the isolation and loneliness of people with intellectual disabilities, Jean invited two men from an institution to live with him in a small home. He called the home L'Arche, a French word for the ark, in the biblical story of Noah and the flood. L'Arche grew quickly and spread around the world, attracting many young people who wanted to help and opening new homes and workshops. L'Arche began in Canada in 1969. Today, there are over 140 L'Arche communities in 40 countries and 6 continents. Toinette moved into the L'Arche community in Trossy-Brille, France, in 1980. She was subsequently at L'Arche, Palestine, for 3 years. In 1986, Toinette, along with her family, joined L'Arche Stratford, and in 1998, Toinette became community leader and director of L'Arche Ontario, or excuse me, L'Arche London. Today, Toinette is regional leader for L'Arche Ontario, consisting of 9 communities. Toinette has several L'Arche members joining her this evening. I will leave it to Toinette to do those introductions. Please join me in warmly welcoming Toinette and all of the L'Arche community joining us here tonight.
Okay, how it seems to work. So it's a privilege for me to be here tonight. It's always a gift to share the gift of L'Arche with friends. And community doesn't happen by yourself, so we are here, a few of us, because it happens in the context of relationships. So I'm here with Paul from our community, Luke, Martha, Nicole, and Corinne. And community is never there just for itself as an island, but we also have a friend, Lorenzo, who has joined me tonight, because the gift of L'Arche is never to be a sect or a closed place. It's a place where vulnerability is welcomed. So Lorenzo joined me tonight as well. So I will try a PowerPoint. I'm not very good with technology, so if I offer you a good laugh, take it, it's free. There's thunder. Thank you. So here, it's in the context we are sponsored tonight by the chaplaincy and the London Catholic School Board. So it was quite appropriate. We just come out of the Christmas season. And this drawing was made by Sami, who is a man who was my age. He was born in 1958, and I lived with him when I was in the big institution in Bethany. He has passed away since. I discovered that Sami was Christian once I brought it close to a wall and between his fingers put a pen, and he drew a nativity scene, which told me he knew it was Christmas, when many of our friends were Muslim in that big institution. So I always, at Christmas time, get that picture out. Underneath it's Rula, and Rula was the founding co-member of our community in Bethany. And I would like to dedicate tonight to Mary, who was my master and teacher in our own community here in London. That was the day Mary celebrated her 50th birthday. The Word was made flesh and dwelt amongst us. And it took our flesh, it took our body, it took our humanity. And it's not an idea, it's a God who became our flesh, who became one of us.
Lorenzo, it's going to be your turn. I have had the privilege to meet Lorenzo a little bit more than a year and a half ago at Parkwood. And I have known that Jean Vanier has been very instrumental in your journey to give you hope. So Lorenzo wrote to introduce Jean to us tonight something. So you want to look for it and then... Okay, we will keep going. Oh, you have it now? It will play?
The enormous cry coming from us. Do you love us? Why have we been abandoned? Has our life any meaning? Do you love us? John Vanier loves us because we are love. Jesus is love. The cross is love. We are the cross. We are not your inspiration. We are reality. Do you love us? I am a professor, but I knew nothing till I lost all. And touched this reality, became this reality. Do you love us? John Vanier brought Toinette to me, brought us together in love. She is in the same boat. That boat is large. The Ark. Also, a covenant, bringing us together on the meaningless sea. But, do you really love us? Can you meet us? Can you be transformed as we have been? Can you see yourself in us? Do you love us as we love you? Love comes from our encounter, our meeting, And to really meet each other, we must show our vulnerability. Love is an open wound, the sacred heart of Jesus with thorns. We truly meet each other in our vulnerability. The word comes from the Latin vulnus, a wound, and vulnerare, to wound. We are wounded and are easily wounded. We are vulnerable. We are lost human beings who need relationship. We have touched the bitter reality. We are forsaken, forgotten. Can you love us, and not just pity us? Can you see the reality we are? Can you love us?
Thank you, Lorenzo, for this poem. I learned a lot from many of my teachers in L'Arche. I mentioned Mary earlier on. And I learned this past almost 2 years in the journey with Lorenzo, who is in his milieu here, being a university professor, but who has spent all that time at Parkwood since, that the reality of vulnerability is one that each one of us can face, and it can happen fast. So I think the night of tonight is that we are all of us called to do ordinary things, little things, small things, but we are invited to do them with an extraordinary love, because our God made himself flesh so that our flesh can become God. This is one of the quotes I learned from Jean when I met him in 1974, the first time. To love is to rejoice in the presence of someone. It's not so much to do that much for someone, but it's to rejoice in the presence. By being with the person is to say, I am happy you are. I am happy to be with you. You give me joy. And when you are not there, I miss you. We live in a world where inclusion is quite a fashionable world. But it only starts when we miss people when they are not there. It's not enough to tolerate people. It's only when people are missed that we know that they are loved and that people know they are loved. Mary has been someone quite important for me on my journey. When I first became community leader in our community here, I knew L'Arche, I knew nothing about social services in Ontario. And I had gone to a meeting downtown, which was a meeting for the service providers, and I came out of it and I felt that small. And I know I am not tall, I am not in an illusion here. I know it's pretty short here, but I thought all the way from downtown to Byron, I said to God, I screamed at God to say, biggest mistake of your life. I am the wrong person. And I came to Cana, and Mary had a spot. Those of us who knew and loved Mary knew Mary's spot. And you did not always challenge Mary's spot because it was her spot. But I came in and Mary said, could you come here? Could you come here? And she invited me to sit by her. And she put her legs on my legs. And Mary had a weak side. She was paralyzed on one side. And she very often had difficulties welcoming her weak side because she was a woman who liked to be independent and do things on her own. But that day she undid her legs and she took her weak hand and she put it in my hand. I've never been blessed by the Pope. I am probably very deprived. But the blessing I received from Mary that day was a great affirmation. She revealed to me that a calling is not because of our competency first, is not because of our stature and our knowledge, but because there is trust between individuals. And it has been a tremendous privilege to journey with Mary until she left us. And I have had the privilege to accompany Mary many nights at the hospital. And a few years ago, I had a mastectomy myself. I was faced with cancer. The first person I spoke to was Mary. I sat by her and I said, all the swearing words you have taught me, I may need them, because I have been quite good at being in the role of caregiver and of advocacy, but I do not know how I am going to be on a stretcher and, with doctors, so your teaching might become handy. And Mary has walked it with me. She has welcomed me, and she's the first person in community I saw after having had surgery. And we have walked that path together in mutuality. I was there for her, and Mary was there for me. So what a privilege it has been. So when I don't know what I'm doing, I often talk to Mary. And it's often, believe me. God has chosen what is weak in the world to confound the strong and the wise. And this is David, and it's another love story. I have had the privilege to meet David at the institution in Southwestern Regional Center. David came from a family of nine, and seven of his siblings had never met him. And I had the privilege to meet David, and we welcomed him in community. And to be trusted by David, who had spent 74 years of his life in a big institution, was a tremendous privilege. God has put his body in our hands. And the body of each one of us is the temple of the Spirit. And David invited us to give him his bath. So did Mary. What an act of trust to give oneself, to give one's trust to somebody else and to be treated with respect and dignity as the temple of the Spirit.
Luke?
Aha, the two of you.
So I'm Luke, and this is my friend Paul. And I never really know where to start with talking about Paul and myself, and I guess I'll start from the beginning. Paul and I live at Bethany House, and I've been there for a little over 2 years now, and every single day I am in awe of just the opportunity I've had to live at Bethany, to live with Paul and to learn from him every single day and to be challenged by Paul every single day and to see the ways that he challenges people all over the place when we go out to places. I've had tremendous opportunities to go out with Paul to Sari Therapeutic Riding and to see the ways that he interacts with the horses, that he interacts with the ponies, the way that he interacts with the volunteers there, and the way that he challenges the volunteers and how they ask questions, and they have come to know Paul, and Paul has invited them in to know him and see those connections built. To be able to build connections with Paul and find mutual interests with Stuart McLean and the Vinyl Cafe and a number of years ago, a couple years ago now, the last show that he did in London, Paul and I had an opportunity to go, and we were almost front row, and just, it was incredible to see Paul interacting with the story as it's being told. Paul's heard a lot of the stories before, and he knew when the jokes were coming, and he'd start laughing before everyone else, because he knew what was coming. And to hear people remarking about how Paul is engaging with, and, oh, he knows the jokes. And, like, being able to share that with people of how Paul knows so much, and to have people inquire about that and see that has been remarkable. Paul loves going outdoors, and to have people ask questions when we're out, that's something I've enjoyed being a part of with Paul, of how he is able to bring about those questions and advocating for himself at times. And Paul is and pills as well, so he's just trying to digest it a bit. But Paul is such a welcoming, loving man that whenever anyone new comes to the house and they go and meet Paul, he interacts with them and he invites them in.
Yeah.
Yeah, so where was I? He is a great welcomer, and he welcomed me in. He knows when I'm in the house. He knows when other people come to the house. He's challenged me to just be at times. I've often want to, you know, do things and feel like I'm productive, but Paul's just, he has a mat in the living room, and he just challenges me, hey, why are you running around the house? Come and hang out. Just come and be. And to have that invitation is great. To have that invitation spread to others is great. There's just so many things I can share that I don't know where to go. But when I'm away on vacation and I come into the house, he'll hear me and he knows that I'm there. It's getting a little happier, I think, now. I've been able to share so much of my life with him. I've been able to take Paul out to my family farm and see him engage with aspects of my life the way that he opens up to that and invites me in to share that with him has been great. And he's, with Larsh and with Paul, I've been challenged a lot as well for what I value in myself and how I identify and what I value within myself and seeing the deeper value of myself and others. There have been, I used to have a great value on my ability to do things. I was an athlete growing up. I had, you know, all these abilities, and I was active and fit and had these, you know, good things. And then one day I had a stroke and lost that for quite a while. And before the stroke, leading up to that, I was challenged constantly of, like, you know, who am I really? What am I finding my worth and my value for myself and my identity? And Paul constantly challenged that of what do I see? What do I see myself being? And I still am challenged every day by that, of what do I see the value in myself, and the challenge to see it deeper in myself, deeper in Paul and everyone else around me, because there's so much more, and I had lost the ability to control the right side of my body for a substantial amount of time, and that all adds up to wondering in the constant challenge of that. And like, Paul knew I was away for a while, and the first day I got out of the hospital, I went back to the house to get my stuff, and you know, I walked in, people are like, hey, Luke's back from the hospital, and Paul heard my voice, and he just started calling out from the living room, and like, Luke's home, and that welcome the first day I moved into the house, that welcome the first day out of the hospital means a lot to me, that I can't even really describe how, like, I'm not doing any justice at all for the impact that Paul has had on me, the impact that Paul has had on everybody that meets him, and I'm just extremely thankful for Paul and being able to even be up here and try to talk about the indescribable blessing that Paul has been to me and has been to everybody that meets him. And yeah, I mean, there's nothing really that I can say that can really match anything that Paul is to me and everyone else. So yeah, I'm just touched in so many ways from my time at Bethany and with Paul and everyone else in L'Arche, and I'm challenged every single day to try to be a better me, to try to find and recognize the deeper value in everyone around me, because there's so much there that is hard to see until we really open ourselves up and look. And I'm just thankful to have that opportunity to continually look every day deeper and deeper.
Thank you, Paul, and thank you, Luke. L'Arche is a story of a pilgrimage, and we are pilgrims together. We are called
We're called to announce the gift of people with learning disabilities and to empower them to take their rightful place in our communities and in our societies.
We are an international federation, so the friends there are from Scotland.
We are called to create flexible models in response to the needs and vulnerability of people in our communities, core members, and assistants, and the needs of people with learning disabilities in our local cultures.
Friends from Kerala in India.
To encourage, support, and sustain membership and commitment of new and long-term members.
That was friends from Brazil.
To foster an environment where we can live out in our daily lives our identity as communities of faith.
And that was a federation in Assisi in 2005.
To integrate and harmonize our faith community and professional lives.
And Raphael is the founding member of L'Arche with Jean Vanier and Philippe and Dan. Raphael has since passed away.
to announce and be a witness to the vision of our common humanity.
And you will recognize a few of us. That's our London community at Christmas. Thank you. So L'Arche International is made up of 142 communities. We have 29 of them in Canada, 9 in Ontario. And when I was in the regional leader, I traveled quite a bit between those 9 communities today, and everywhere that same reality of L'Arche is lived. Our identity. We are people with and without learning disabilities, sharing life together in communities of faith. Yeah.
Mutual relationships and trust in God are at the heart of our life together.
We seek to build a world that recognizes the unique value of every person and our need for one another.
And we have friends from L'Arche in France here. Our mission is
to make known the gifts of people with learning disabilities revealed through mutually transforming relationships.
Our community in Honduras here.
Engage in our diverse cultures, working together towards a more human society.
Cleveland in the U.S.
Foster an environment in communities that is inspired by the core values of our founding story and that responds to the changing needs of our members.
Friends in Argentina. So our mission is to make known the gifts of people with learning disabilities revealed through mutuality transforming relationships. And that's the theme of tonight. It's all about relationships. And we end those relationships in our diverse cultures, and we work together toward a more human society. Foster an environment and community that is inspired by the core values of our founding story. And our story started in 1964 when Jean Vanier started and welcomed Raphael, Philippe, and Dan. And since then, L'Arche has grown. It responds to the changing needs of our members. So love doesn't mean doing extraordinary things. It means knowing how to do simple things with extraordinary love. I think this is the teaching of L'Arche is really. It's to do simple things. Jean keeps repeating, in fact, we probably spend 50% of our time making the house dirty and the other 50 cleaning it up. And that's basically what community life is about. We spend lots of time around the table. We spend lots of time wasting time. For us, Christian, it's very similar to what prayer is. I don't know about your prayer life, I know about mine, which more of the time is a struggle rather than anything else. But it's giving time to God, trying to listen, and to cut off the monkey spirit in me which keeps yakking and having something important to do, someone to call, someone to write to, and so on, and trying to stop and to listen. And to listen to God, and it's not very different. I have the privilege tonight to be here with Corinne and Martha, and since I have transitioned to the regional leader, I am not very much in our own community here. But my place of friendship is with Martha and Corinne. And Martha is a woman of no words. Does not speak. Her invitation to me is to shut up. Her invitation to me is to stop. Her invitation to me is to be. here, now, and listen, and be, and pay attention. Learn my language. Don't come with your agenda. Learn my language. Listen. Be there. Be present. And that's a tremendous gift. It's not all quiet. Not all of us in community are as quiet as you, Martha. Some of us are louder. And some of us do like to talk. And so there is lots of life in community. There is lots of dancing, lots of music. Eating together matter. And not just rushing through the meal, but listening to what was your day like? What happened in your day which mattered today? Was it a meal you enjoyed? And we need to confess that tonight we had a great meal. I don't know who was the cook, but the meal was great. We would not have ordered a better meal in town. Right, Corinne? The chocolate was good. And pasta was okay, so that was fantastic. So I have lots of gratitude to offer tonight. First, to be invited to share the gift, because the gift of L'Arche is a gift which has shaped my life. I met Jean Vanier when I was rather young, in 1974. That sentence I quoted earlier on, to love is to reveal, has stayed with me since 1974. I didn't know then that I would ever go to L'Arche. I thought that was good for him. He had the privilege to not be a priest or a religious, he was a lay person, so that was attractive somewhat because there was room in the church for people who were not in the orders or so, that lay people could have something to offer. So I found that appealing at the time. And I would say that Jean has been for me, I was going to say the father of my soul in a way. He is the one who has showed me the way in our church where there is a voice for people who are, that we push on the margin, as well as for lay people to take their place, because the word became flesh in each one of us, with a preference for the poor and the rejected, but all of us, and the place in me which I reject, that's where Jesus wants to meet me, asking, where is your pain? The way he asked the woman of Samaria, when she was seated at noon by the well, he came to her and he didn't judge her. But he said to her, "Lady, what are you doing in full sun, fetching water? Where is your pain?" And I think Jesus, to each one of us, invites and asks the question, "Where is your pain?" And Jean would say that the people that we have the privilege to live with, and I've been in L'Arche since 1980, are probably the most rejected people. When there is a war, when there is an earthquake, where there are floods in a country, we never speak of those people. They are the voicelesses. They are without voice, without a name. In fact, quite often, today, they are the people who do not have the right to be born. But it only starts at birth, when a young woman or a woman is expecting. Where is the community to hold the journey of the person there? I would like to finish by a story that Jean shared when he went to Chile a number of years ago. He was invited there and he was driven from the airport. And he drove on a street and the chauffeur said, "On this side, you have those tremendous, huge properties with police and guards. And on the other side, you have the bidonville, the slums. And no one crossed that street. No one goes from one side to the other."
And I would say the calling, our vocation as L'Arche, is to take the risk to cross the street to meet the other. Jean speaks very often of the Gospel of John, which is a gospel of the encounter, the gospel of a meeting, the meeting of someone of different gender, different religion, different creeds, different, but all mothers around the world do cry with the same tears, the tears of pain. And they taste as bad, no matter which side someone is. We live today in a world where lots of walls are being built. And it's a bit scary at the moment, the political agenda of our world. I was happy to see a number of years ago the wall in Germany, you know, being broken down so that, but we know of walls. I myself have climbed the walls between Israel and the West Bank. The call, which is ours as followers of Jesus, is one to build bridges, to take the risk to cross that street and to meet the other, to meet the person. Not so much for the idea we have of them, but to meet the person for who he is, who she is. And for us in the Catholic world, in the Anglican world, in our churches, if we have the nerve to go to church on Sunday, to receive communion, to say Amen, and to not say Amen, to walk with people who are in pain, we need to reflect. The words hypocrite are for us. So it's very important for us to be rooted in the calling which is ours. It's our calling in L'Arche. It's our calling as followers of Jesus. And tonight, the vocation of L'Arche is an invitation to live by the sacrament of the meeting, the sacrament of the encounter, and to go and meet the other, not to resolve his or her problems, to welcome the person. So I would like us to watch a small video, which we have a series of videos made by L'Arche International once a month at the moment. And they give a voice to people with intellectual disabilities in different parts of the world. At the last potluck, Marietta, you helped us meet Raffaella from the community in Bologna. And the story of Raffaella was one where she could give love to her father before he left this world. Tonight we are going to meet another one of the members of our communities here. Yeah.
Va, qu'elle est, elle est bien. Moi, ma femme, bien allé pendant que on y allait. Ma fille, ma fille.
Thank you. c'est sur toi qu'on fait le film, hein?
Oui.
L'électricité, ça allait. L'eau, ça allait. Mais la nourriture, on n'en trouvait pas. Les médicaments, on ne peut pas en trouver. Quand tu vois quelqu'un qui fait des crises d'épilepsie, qui n'a pas son traitement, ça va lui rendre encore plus faible. Personne ne peut se trouver au dehors.
Et toute la ville de Boaké était en train de se vider.
Mais lui seulement, ce qu'il voulait, c'est de saluer ses amis. Et c'est là qu'il a escaladé la clôture. Avec les coups de feu qui résonnent partout. Et les gens qui l'ont vu dans la ville ont commencé à crier, « Ndianda, vous êtes arrivés !» Colonel, il reste toujours ce monsieur qui n'oublie jamais ses amis. J'ai regardé le ciel et puis j'ai dit à Dieu, mais tu ne vas pas nous faire ça. Tu ne vas pas nous faire ça. Et quand je suis rentré, j'ai mis la clé, la voiture a démarré, j'ai fait. Dieu merci. Donc, c'était la voiture de l'âge seul qui était ce jour-là sur la route. Certains avaient peur parce que les rebelles sont déjà cachés sur les routes et qu'ils peuvent assassiner tous. Quand on est arrivé à Yamoussoukro, l'armée nous a arrêtés. Ils ont dit, bon, écoutez, dès que votre véhicule est parti, les rebelles sont arrivés sur les lieux, ils ont chassé tout le monde. J'ai pris le courage du colonel. Si le colonel, dans la guerre, il veut aller voir ses amis, et que moi, j'ai mes amis qui sont restés de l'autre côté, c'est tout à fait normal que je retourne pour venir les chercher. Il faut retourner aller chercher les autres.
If you visit the L'Arche International site, there are seven of those very short films, which have been filmed in different parts of the world. So, to conclude, I think that the words from St. Paul's to the Corinthians are pretty appropriate for us tonight. Christ is like a single body, which has many parts. It is still one body, even though it is made up of different parts, in the same ways. All of us, Jews or Gentiles, whether slaves or free, have been baptized into the one body by the same Spirit. And we have all been given the one Spirit to drink. For the body itself is not made up of only one part, but of many parts. If the foot were to say, because I'm not a hand, I don't belong to the body, that would not keep it from being a part of the body. And if the ear were to say, because I'm not an eye, I don't belong to the body, that would not keep it from being a part of the body. If the whole body were just an eye, how could it hear? And if it were only an ear, how could it smell? As it is, however, God put every different part in the body just as he wanted. There would not be a body if it were only one part. On the contrary, we cannot do without the parts of the body that seem to be weaker. The parts of the body that aren't worth very much are the ones which we treat with greater care, which the part of the body which don't look very nice are treated with special modesty, which the more beautiful parts do not need. And God himself has put the body together in such a way as to give greater honor to the part that needed. And so there is no division in the body. All of you are Christ's body. So I think St. Paul here, and I invite you to read the full text, but gives us a great vision, a vision of a society where vulnerability is honored, respected, welcomed. And that's the call of L'Arche in a way, to build real relationship with real people. And there are moments of great joy, and there are moments where we need to ask for forgiveness. But it's no different than any good families, any good parishes, any good organization, school system, university. But I think that's the vision that we have received and that we are called to honor. So thank you again for having us. And I think that we are going to have questions. Maybe we have questions to you, but maybe you have questions for us. I don't know. You know, Luke, Nicole, Corinne, Martha, Paul, Lorenzo, we would be happy to respond to questions if you have any questions for us.
Do you have the mic? Ah.
So there can be, you know, they are all good questions. That's what I need to say. And if we put you to sleep, it's not a bad thing. So many people have trouble sleeping, so we feel good about that too.
Pam?
I'll ask you a question. Toinette, you've been doing this for a long time, as you pointed out. Could you share with us what's the most encouraging thing you've seen in the last decade in the field of disability around relationships? L'Arche has been talking about mutual transformative relationships for a long time. That hasn't always been big in the rest of the field, but in the school boards or in other people that you work with in the field, what gives you hope in the last decade or so? It's good. I wasn't going for humor, but I'm glad it's that.
Well, it was interesting. This past Monday, I was at Queen's Park meeting with the Assistant Deputy Minister, Karen Chan. And it was interesting to hear her speak of intentional community. And I attended a forum the week before, a housing forum for people with intellectual disabilities, and the word intentional community was also named. So I asked Karen, I said, I mean, I would like to hear from you your definition of intentional community. Are we talking neighborhood watch in order to not inject dollars in the system? Or are we talking about real relationship? Because I can tell you, we have been around since 64. We know something about intentional community, and we can stand in the name of a certain expertise here. We know that it does not happen without intentionality, it does not happen without resources, and it doesn't happen overnight. As I named earlier on in my presentation, it's not enough to welcome people in a classroom to say inclusion has happened. I started in the world as a teacher. And it was in a small town in France. And I was given two different grades. And I was told, and by the way, there is a little guy in the classroom whose needs are a bit different. I said, no problem, I love adventure. That little guy was named Vincent, and this little man had Down syndrome. Nothing wrong with that, it's a tremendous gift. What was wrong, though, was the fact that the teachers who came out of teachers' college, like I did, had 0.2% training on disabilities and on Down syndrome and inclusion. So it's when it's fashionable and inclusion, it's beautiful, but it's not enough. I remember one night in February in winter being seated by the fireplace at the place I lived, and I had prepared by the seat of my pants my two curriculum for the next day. I was dead tired. My prayer at that moment was, I hope that tomorrow Vincent is going to be quiet. And then I thought, this is pretty poor goal for a classroom as a teacher. What's wrong in that picture? So I think we have come a long way. We have come a long way. We have closed the institution. David and Mary lived in big institutions where there were big walls around. We need to pay attention to the invisible walls of today. We need to pay attention, and we are a bit of a risk-averse culture. So in order to be in relationship, you need to be invested with real people, and relationships have highs and lows. So I would say we have come a long way. We name the fact that we cannot have that wall, but we need to remain vigilant, I would say. And then, as I named, the word intentional community being in the sector gave me some hope somewhere. I don't know if it answers your question. Thank you. She's kind to me.
Toinette, a book that has greatly inspired me through the years is Jean Vanier's Becoming Human. And I feel that tonight you have spoken to many of those ideas and values that he writes about. I'm wondering, could you share with us a bit about what you feel have been the most important parts for you in becoming human in your experience with L'Arche.
In the second slide, there was a man by the name of Patrick. I would say Jean Vanier has been the John the Baptist in my life. He has pointed to people who like Patrick, and I was invited to live in Patrick's home in Trolley. And Patrick is the reason I am in L'Arche today. But I was born in Brittany, in Catholic western part of France there, and I don't think I have ever seen my mother being angry. That was not an emotion for a woman in the farming community I came from that was expressed. I have seen mom being resentful or shut down and withdraw, but I had never seen mom angry. When I came to L'Arche, I lived with Patrick and five other people in our homes, and Patrick was a man who had been wounded by life a lot, and he was very angry, and he showed it. And he expressed it. And I didn't know what to do with that. I mean, I had no idea how to welcome his anger. And I kept pretending that I was never angry anyhow. That was his problem. But there was a point where either if I were going to stay, I had to go through facing the fact that he was an expert at pushing my buttons, better than anybody else, and that touched my anger at a place that I could not hide, not to be angry. I did lots of journaling at that time, and tried to identify what was it that Patrick was touching in me, which made me want to, not to laugh at all, Corinne. I wanted to strangle him, I think. I was just at a point to say, crap. I would love to look pious and spiritual, but when I'm in front of that, forget it all. I just want to push him and to do things that I don't feel very proud. So I had to welcome my own humanity with my light and my darkness. And anger was an emotion, as I named, that I didn't know what to do with. And I think Patrick has been a tremendous master for me to know that I too was angry. As angry as he was, I didn't get as wet as he was when he did, and I didn't necessarily. So what we do with our anger is probably the most important question to ask once we realize we have it. So that was for me very important. The other emotion, I would say, that I have learned is tenderness. And I think exactly that, tenderness. But when I think of Mary, whom I mentioned earlier, Mary had some days lots of anger as well, same as Patrick. But I have seen the face of tenderness in Mary more than in many people. The picture I showed there was one where she showed her tenderness, and when she would welcome you to that place of tenderness, you knew that it was something of the nature of communion, I would say. Something quite sacred. And I see Louisa nodding her head. It was a tenderness, so that's another thing I have learned. And I have dared, because she empowered me to show tenderness as well, and to welcome tenderness. I remember also David. I remember visiting David at the institution at Southwestern Regional Center. And he had a reputation of ahead of him to say he was a grumpy old man. That's all there was to it. Friends of the building, and I walked those corridors, and they seemed to never end. The nurse had a bike. Those corridors were so long. And I made it to David, and it was after I had been away for 2 weeks. And I thought he has seen hundreds of people come around, right? So, and he's mad, he's upset, so that's going to be what's going to be. And I remember coming in the ward where he was, and Paul, you were on the other side,
And I came to David, and he only had one eye and one hand. But he looked at me, he grabbed my head from the back, he brought it to his forehead at least 7 times, and he smiled the way David could smile. And I welcomed him as if saying, "Where have you been?" But I didn't see the grumpiness I was described at the door, and had he been grumpy, I would have been there too. So I think I have discovered tenderness. I have discovered anger. I have discovered real feelings and taken the risk to express them, which Jean speaks of in the book Becoming Human, for his own journey. Jim, did you have your hand up? You have not seen that guy in ages, yeah? I saw him in September. I had a meal with him, and he was rather well. He had just turned 88. I know. Yeah. And this week I was told he was in Brittany taking a bit of vacation away from community to recharge his battery. Yeah, Melissa. When can you meet him before he dies? No. I don't organize those things very well, right? I need to meet him before you should talk to your community leader. No, I understand, Melissa. That's a great... Maybe there are a few things you can do for that. Save money every week, you know, in order to get a flight to go to... Well, it's a few, it's $700, $800. It's lots of money. No, we have Euro, France has euros. So we can talk a little bit more. But I would suggest you talk to your house leader, your community leader, and I support the project, but that's a personal opinion. Mike? Sorry, I didn't think of coming.
What do you do, Enosh?
What is the best thing about Marsh?
Tell me, Mike, what is the best thing for you about Marsh?
What do you love about Marsh? The Marsh is the tools, the painting and singing and dancing, and we do helping and others to do stuff.
Thank you, Mike. Yes. Dancing, singing, painting, yeah. Hugging.
Yes.
That's you and I have that in common. Winnie.
Animal.
Hi, Ramon.
Animal. Adimi. Timmy. Namo. Mom. Ame.
Yeah.
Tipo. Namo. Animal.
Thank you, Billy.
Thank you.
Thank you. So, in fact, a few of us here, we have in Lush in London 3 homes. So some of us are at Cana, some of us at Jubilee, Winnie, and some of us at Bethany. So we have 3 homes. We have also a day program, and that's where the activities that Mike spoke of do happen. And right now we are itinerant. We go from Byron United Church to Youth for Christ to St. George to St. Anne's Anglican Church to. But you have probably heard or seen that we are also building a gathering place where we will be delighted to invite you to join us for art classes, for dancing, Zumba, other activities. And we will invite also other friends from the City of London to join us for that. Is there a question brewing in here? I feel that it's coming. I feel it.
When are you coming to speak at a disability? When are you coming to speak at a disability studies class?
I don't understand their questions. You can tell they are students. They know how to rephrase it to really make sure. With joy. I mean, there is not a bigger gift for me. Lush has been a biggest gift for me in my life. I have had very good professors at university back in France, here on campus, and being here at King's makes me think of Dr. Morgan, to whom I owe quite a bit. I really appreciated learning about death in this culture. I was completely scandalized by death in North American culture. I had called Dr. Morgan and I said, you seem to have lots of books and lots of writing and give classes. Can I talk to you? So he said, well, sure, come. So I had met him and I took the certificate in thanatology here at King's. This building did not exist at the time, but it was a good time in my life. I have no idea why I said that, in fact. Anyhow, it was. Who were my true teacher? Thank you, Laurel. I'm glad you are part of my life. Yeah. So, but yes, Patrick, Sammy, Mary, David, Corinne, Martha today remain my true teacher. In order for me to say my yes to the region, to visit the other communities, it's very important for me to be rooted at Kena and in the friendship that Corinne and Martha offer me. It's a powerful reminder that relationships are not something of the past. Relationships are of today, and they evolve and they change because I am older, because my needs are different, because we are. And Corinne, a number of months ago, it was a privilege to be at the hospital with you, and there was your family there, there was your house leader, and then the doctor team asked me, and who are you? She seems to get along with you. Well, I said, I am a friend. And it was a special moment for me to be there. And I was not on the payroll, I was not there because I had to be, but I could only be a friend. And I think that's what I enjoy doing together today with Corinne and Martha in a number of capacity, but it's the friend that guides me, and I need it. And I believe that we both need it. Sometimes a good chocolate does good to more than one person at a time, so. I am grateful for that. Other questions for Paul, for Luke, for Lorenzo, who is hiding? But the message of Lush, and that's what Lorenzo speaks of tonight, is never a message to stay within. A community is never there for itself. A community is there to witness to the values of life and to take it elsewhere. And we belong to each other, not because we have chosen each other, but together we belong. And we belong to the human family, and becoming human is exactly that. Gloria. He has been there since January 14th, 9 years ago. We had snow, that's right. I remember when Paul came. Yeah. Tony is over there. Yeah.
9 years ago, yes, that's a long time, eh?
Before Lorenzo needs to leave, I would like to offer my greatest gratitude. Lorenzo, Corinne, Nicole, Martha, Luke, and Paul, and of course, Toinette, all of you for sharing your time, your wisdom, your care, and your love with us tonight. Thank you so much. I would now like to ask Mrs. Barb Broom, principal of St. Patrick Catholic Elementary School in Lucan, to come now and offer a word of thanks.
I'm very pleased to offer thanks to the members of the L'Arche community on behalf of those who were gathered here this evening. Toinette said, community doesn't occur in isolation. It occurs among friends. This evening, we learned from the L'Arche members the importance of authentic, supportive relationships. Dr. Lorenzo Minnelli and Luke spoke of how vulnerable we are and offered gratitude for the self-awareness that arises when we are challenged. We are the cross, and the cross is loved. Toinette shared with us that we're called to do ordinary things with extraordinary love. We will indeed leave this hall tonight, inspired by the mission statement of L'Arche, to make known the gifts of people with learning disabilities through mutually transforming relationships. After we leave tonight, we will imagine the world differently. Thank you very much.
I promised my community that I would promote the L'Arche London Banquet, so I do my due diligence here. February 24th, if you have not yet purchased your ticket or your table, it's not too late. There is the L'Arche Banquet. And at L'Arche, we are people of the table. Sharing the bread and sharing our story is where we meet and encounter. So February 24th, at the Double Tree, I think. Okay. Double Tree by Hilton at 6 o'clock. And there is information at the door, right, Marietta? Thank you.
Sorry. One more quick announcement before you go. Our next lecture, please consider joining us if you are able on Thursday, February 2nd, to hear from Reverend Dr. Lizette Larson-Miller, our very own from here in London at Huron University College, who has joined us here tonight, is being pointed at, so you can see who she is there, not to embarrass her. She will be speaking with us about Christian unity through prayer, so please don't miss that. It'll be a wonderful evening. Thank you again for joining us tonight. Take care and God bless.
Thank you. Thank you for your question.